this to strangers was known far and wide, had found favor in the eyes of God. It was unknown to Abraham that this was God in the company of two angels.
Peace be with you, brothers, and welcome to my tent. Will you not rest and refresh yourself in the shade and take a poor meal with us before you go on? Get hence. Set a fine calf to roast on the coals. Draw cream and butter from the stone box and honey, the new honey from Egypt. Set three large loaves of bread to bake. These gentle sojourners have walked a long way, and they will certainly be in appetite.
God knew that Abraham was very fond of his nephew Lot, and had come to give him important news. In the Hebrew custom of gratitude, the visitors blessed the people of Abraham.
Gentlemen go in the heat of the day.
Questions? Of strangers and guests? For shame, wife.
The time came for God to reveal his identity and his mission to Abraham. The cities of the plain had become an abomination on the earth. Their incurable wickedness had made them a cancer, and for that they would be totally destroyed.
But my Lord God, my nephew and his family live in the city of Sodom. Certainly thee would not destroy the good along with the bad.
God brought this news to Abraham, as it was his intention to spare Abraham's nephew Lot and his family. But for all the others in those cities, there was no hope.
Well, my objection to this part of the Bible is the depiction of the country as a well-watered, well-fertile area capable of sustaining large herds of cattle. In reality, it's a harsh parchland, and certainly not a place that two Bedouin herdmen could become rich during a generation.
This criticism of the Bible is worth investigating. We put the issue to a highly respected meteorologist and climatologist who specializes in ancient weather patterns.
It is naive to assume that the climate of Palestine has remained the same from ancient times as it is today. We know that in Palestine, in the past, there were heavy forest lands and grasslands, and so in Abraham's time, as the Bible states, this particular part of the world was capable of supporting his flocks and the fact that he could make a grand living in this part of the world.
As we continue our story, the two angels approach Sodom while the last rays of daylight are fading from the sky. As Lot was concluding his business day, the town was in full celebration of a pagan holiday called Revel.
Gentlemen, I perceive you to be strangers. Do you have friends in the city or a lodging for the night?
We are unknown in the city, sir.
We shall abide the night in the street.
That would not be wise, sir. This is the first night of the Astarte revel. Strangers are not liked in the city of Sodom.
We thank you for warning us.
I have a good and secure house where my wife and daughters will set out a nice supper. Come, I beg you, and abide the dark hours inside.
You follow God's ways. We accept, sir.
Come.
It is God's blessing we have our guests to sup with us. And no one knows that they are here.
I needed salt. Because of our guests, I borrowed from Ismet, our neighbor. Certain she would say nothing.
be that disturbed this house in the late hour.
Who in there? You son of a camel! You abide in our city and live as we do! Send the strangers out now!
Because you're rich and your uncle is Abraham, you think you can scorn us?
To destroy this evil place and the other cities of abomination.
Have you any other family not living under this roof?
The men who will become my sons-in-law.
When the first light breaks, gather up all of your family and those goods you can carry.
Make haste that you depart this city at dawn, for we have come to destroy it with fire and brimstone.
Over the years, critics of the literal interpretation of the Bible have dismissed these verses as allegory, pure and simple, telling one story to get a different point across. The criticism is centered on one key issue. There was no evidence that the five cities destroyed by God ever existed. No evidence, that is, until recently.
The Ebla Geographical Atlas. This comes from the mid-third millennium B.C. It's a list which contains the names of 290 ancient place names. Several of these bear upon Genesis 14 and the cities of the plain. Name number 211 is Sodom, perfectly equivalent, clear to read, and phonetically equivalent with the biblical Sodom.
One of the biggest reasons for locating Sodom and Gomorrah toward the southern end of the Dead Sea is because of its association with the city of Tsoar. It was to Tsoar that Lot and his daughters fled after the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Tsoar is located, according to the Medeba mosaic map, discovered a few years ago in a Byzantine church in what is now Jordan, in the southeast area of the Dead Sea region.
In the first light of morning, while Sodom still echoed with the pagan rebels, Lot obeyed the orders of the avenging angels and prepared to leave the city, taking only what they could carry.
Where are the sons-in-law to speak to your daughters?
They did not believe me. They hear the music still playing. They think I am making a joke or telling a lie.
Then they are doomed. Hurry, there's little time. And do not look back.
Is it really true, my lord? God commands you to destroy this city? This and all the cities of the plain.
But not Zoar. Certainly not Zoar.
Where shall we go? Stay.
We will spare Zoar from the destruction you have passed beyond this. But go. Go now and remember that you and your family cannot look back, or you most certainly will die.
Husband, I think this is great foolishness. What is in your mind? Why are we turned out of our house and put on the road like this?
Because those men are angels of the Lord God, who this day will destroy the city.
How do you know such things?
They told me. But God is to spare us.
I cannot believe that we have been herded out of our house in the cold dawn on the word of two strangers
that
came in the night.
Tempt not Almighty God.
Thank you.
Move on.
Go on.
Go on.
Anyone who denies this fact is simply engaging in fantasy or speculation.
The temple towers of Mesopotamia were centers for communicating with ancient astronauts.
I believe the tower was intended as a communications device, but not with any so-called ancient astronauts, rather with the spirit world of demons and fallen angels.
The Bible explains that God became angry at the first civilization that sprang from Noah. To find out why, let's look at the beginning of this story as set forth in the Bible. According to Genesis chapter 8, when the floodwaters began to recede, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. Noah and his family descended the mountain to begin life with men. God had commanded that they should not remain in one place, but should go forth, be fruitful, and replenish the earth. But the descendants of Noah violated God's edict. They settled in the fertile plain between the Tigris and the Euphrates River. When they began building a tower to the heavens, God decided to disperse them. Is this account of the story of Babel fact or fiction? Why was this tower really built, and by whom? Is it possible that all the races and languages of the world sprang from one single location, as the Bible claims? As we consider these questions, let's take a look at what was happening in the land of Shinar. The Bible doesn't tell us why King Nimrod and his people affronted God with their arrogance. So we have a double mystery to explore. First, was there ever actually a Tower of Babel? And secondly, did all the races and languages of the world result from the destruction of that tower?
Oh, mighty King Nimrod! Hearken to the word! God of our grandfathers' grandfathers, cried out in warning! Go out and make new nations! Stay not here to fight God! Will ye bring down the floodwaters again?
Now, what was your complaint, Judea?
Not a complaint, Majesty. What the old beggar cries in the street is whispered in some corner.
Well, who is this God? What is his name? Because of some old women's tales, we should give up the power and riches we have here. Who is this God that says this to me? Priest?
I know no God mightier than your Majesty. The old fools say he sent the great flood in the time of our ancestors.
Well, he shall bring no blood against me or my city. You see this tower? We will build this tower until it reaches the heavens. No flood of water shall ever bring it down. How say you, architect?
With this tower, mighty lord, you will prevail against any god, and you shall be equal to any in heaven.
For centuries, skeptics challenged the Bible's accuracy on the Tower of Babel because they believed the land of Shinar, as referred to in the Bible, had never existed. To understand this point better, we asked Professor David C. Duell, an expert in Old Testament studies, to explain.
Scholars and students of the Bible questioned the location, even the existence, of the land of Shinar. Then in the early part of the last century, archaeologists brought forth thousands of cuneiform tablets like this one. On such tablets from Egypt, Syria, and the Hittite and Hurrian kingdoms was the name Shinar in various pronunciations.
The land where the biblical story was set was here, in what is now Iraq. The historians of antiquity, including Alexander the Great, all wrote about having seen the ruins of the Tower of Babel. There have been innumerable archaeological digs over the past 100 years that have unearthed the great treasures of Sumer, Assyria, and Babylon in Iraq. The Beer's Nimrud site at Borsippa has been favored by many archaeologists as the Tower of Babel. The Ziggurat of Ur and the ruins of Entamanaki near Babylon are even more favored. Is one of these sites the possible location for the Tower of Babel?
The strongest body of archaeological evidence, combined with the biblical account, favors the location of Entamanaki, which is in the country of Iraq, the city of Babylon, 50 miles south of Baghdad. This site was recently featured in a Reader's Digest reference book as the probable site for the location of the Tower of Babel. Today, in the city of Babylon, a model of this tower is featured in the Nebuchadnezzar Museum.
The building of the tower, in its grand design, put a heavy burden on both people and resources. Construction of the tower soon demanded more and more laborers and money. Nimrod became a tyrant, and his heavy hand was felt in every quarter. The tower was to be more than a monument to human vanity. It was meant to put Nimrod closer to heaven, where he might more easily capture the favors of the gods. He hoped to spread his influence by communicating directly with them.
You see, Majesty, how very hard burning these bricks makes them. Much harder than the bricks that are hardened by the sun. Can these new bricks of yours build this tower so mighty that it could reach to heaven itself? From this tower, as the sun is lord of the sky, we shall reach into the domains of heaven itself. Then, Your Majesty, you and the priest will be able to talk with the gods.
In recent years, some rather exotic theories have been put forth to explain the purpose behind the tower. One theory suggests the tower had something to do with so-called ancient astronauts, a race of spacemen from beyond our solar system who colonized this planet. Ancient people called them the gods.
Now, the Sumerians were able to describe them and depict them, for example, in statuettes, just as this one, which was of the leader of the first group of astronauts who splashed down in the Persian Gulf. There were others among them who were females, for example, and you can see that they really were pilots who could fly in the skies of Earth. These then were the people whom the Bible describes as the ancient gods in whom the ancient peoples believed.
Although the ancient astronaut theory is interesting, it involves a total misreading of the scripture. The Hebrew word is B'nai Elohim, which means Elohim, angels, supernatural beings, not astronauts or spacemen. All these quaint ideas and theories emerge from a failure to understand the integrity of the Bible as a whole, which is in itself an integrated message system of extraterrestrial origin.
Another intriguing clue is the possible use of the ancient towers for communications purposes, as author Roger Oakman proposes.
For the Bible says the tower was intended to reach into the heavens, it was not in a physical sense, but rather as a communication system. See, they would have been using quartz crystals, like this quartz crystal I have here on my desk. And if you stack them in the right lengths, it will bring in radio waves. Chapter 11 of Genesis says that the tower was constructed of burnt bricks. That means that they were burned thoroughly. And made with sand and heated under intense heat, these bricks would have acquired a quartz-like nature, making it like a giant crystal radio set.
The Bible says that God decided the tower should not continue to stand, and that the people would have to be encouraged to separate and disperse over the earth.
You tell us of these dark clouds and thunderbolts to surround the tower, lady.
These are very disturbing to the king. He closes himself up in his throne room with great worry.
We have always had storms at this time of the year. I see no connection with thunderstorms in the tower.
I have no memory of dark clouds hovering for so long in one place. Star of lightning bolts that have already killed some of our workers. There is an omen of these things, I tell you.
Then why don't you conjure the storms away? Tell the gods we have had enough.
I would not speak blasphemy if I were you. Perhaps your mockery is heard. It is dark while the day is not yet old. Let's find shelter before we are destroyed with the curse of wind.
Where's my torch? You see? Do you see, you fools?
It's happening again. Why am I being destroyed?
Not so, gracious Majesty. It is only the weather again.
Are not the weather and the gods one of the same, priest? Priest, why have you not taken to the gods with sacrifice? Are you anxious to see me dead?
Most wondrous lord, I burn an ox and two sheep this morning on the altar.
Not enough! Don't you see every dry out enough? Burn more ox and sheep. A child. Yes. A newborn infant. No, no. Not one. 50. Throw 50 newborn infants into the sacrificial fire.
Will be rebuilt before the final battle at Armageddon. These ruins lost for centuries under the shifting sands of Iraq, have now been fully uncovered. In these recently made films, it can be seen that the reconstruction of ancient Babylon is, in fact, a reality. This has long been a pet project of the Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein, and his engineers, architects, and archaeologists assure him that the city is rising once more. Several of the buildings have now been completed. Plans are also underway for a complete reconstruction of the Tower of Babel. The world does not know Saddam Hussein's motives for the rebuilding of Babylon and the fabled Tower of Babel. Let us all hope that his plans for the resurrection of once mighty Babylon is cultural and peaceful only. We can live with the mystery surrounding the Tower of Babel, but the world cannot afford a modern nuclear-armed Nebuchadnezzar in the form of Saddam Hussein.
On the face of it, the story of the burning bush is pure fiction, or at least mythology. It smacks of pious enthusiasm. The idea that a bush can be burning and still exist is just not within the realm of possibility.
The biblical story of the burning bush is completely true and totally provable. The idea that hundreds of thousands of Israelites passed through the Red Sea is crazy. The Bible says that there were 603,000 males, which means over 2 million people who passed through those waters. It most likely would have taken several weeks for all those people just to cross. The whole idea is crazy. Based on recent developments in physical oceanography and meteorology, we can prove today that crossing of the Red Sea would have been possible.
From the burning bush to the parting of the Red Sea, the story of the Israelites' exodus out of Egypt has been a constant source of disagreement among the experts. The Bible gives a remarkable account about the man known as Moses. According to the story, the Israelites were a people enslaved in Egypt. They were growing in numbers, much to the concern of their Egyptian slave masters. Because of this, the Pharaoh ordered all of the Hebrew children to be slain. A young mother, one of the enslaved Israelites, could no longer protect her infant son. She put him in a basket and set him afloat in the Nile River near the palace of the Pharaoh. A princess of Egypt found the basket and took the infant to raise as her own. She called the child Moses. Raised in royal surroundings, it was not until Moses reached manhood that he discovered the truth of his heritage. The story of the Israelites' exodus out of Egypt has been a constant source of disagreement among the experts. Proof of the story of Exodus in the Bible depends on the answers to three questions. Was Moses a real person? Was there really an enslaved people called Israelites? And was it possible that the Red Sea actually parted, as stated in the Bible?
Why do you rest, Bud? Get to work!
After Moses discovered that he too was a Hebrew, he began to take a deeper, more sympathetic interest in his own people. And he began to witness their ill treatment, his anger and resentment. He began to grow toward the Egyptians.
Stay your hands, pitmaster! Why do you lash this man? Man, these are not men, my lord, but lazy dogs, and the scourge is the only language they understand. Now get to it! Hey!
Moses fled to the wilderness of Midian and escaped the Pharaoh's death sentence. He was befriended by Jethro, a Midianite priest. He married his daughter. For 40 years, Moses lived the simple life of a shepherd. Then, in a matter of minutes, he came to know his destiny when, for the first time, God's voice spoke to him from the midst of a bush that flamed brightly but was not destroyed.
I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I have seen the misery of my people who are enslaved in Egypt. You, Moses, are going to go to Pharaoh and lead my people out of their bondage in Egypt.
Who am I to lead the Israelites out of Egypt? Why should Pharaoh listen to me?
Do not fear, for I shall be with you. Take your brother Aaron and go now.
Moses' encounter with the burning bush is one of the most memorable stories in the Bible, and certainly one of the most controversial. We are told by the Bible that not only did the bush burst into flame, but it was not consumed by the fire. This has long been questioned by Bible critics. So he went to Israel to question the experts there on the subject.
At the foot of Mount Sinai, one finds the monastery of St. Catherine. The local story of the shepherds, the nomadic people, the Bedouins, do hold that the actual bush that is found inside the monastery is still the same bush.
I can't confirm or reject that the bush growing at the monastery was the actual burning bush, but it is a specific desert plant that fits the biblical description. It's the fractionella or gas plant, Dichomnus albus, a sturdy perennial bush with white or purple flowers, common in the Middle East. The bush produces an oil so volatile that it can be ignited by the sun. The oil quickly burns up, but the bush itself is not damaged.
Ramses II was a formidable and headstrong young man, a builder of cities and great temples. He even created the first shipping canal between the Nile River and the Red Sea, 3,000 years before the Suez Canal. Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and pleaded for the release of their people. But Pharaoh rejected their pleas, and Moses called down 10 plagues on the land. After each plague, Moses went to Pharaoh and gave him the chance to obey God's command by letting the Israelites go. But each time, the Pharaoh refused.
The main purpose of the Exodus story is not to describe history. The main purpose of the Exodus story, as it was created by the priest-scribes who lived in Jerusalem, was to glorify their God and to make their God look greater than any other God. And what they used was a series of old legends and distorted memories which they put together to create this story, which has no relationship to history.
There's an ancient Egyptian papyrus document called the Ippur Papyrus, and it recounts in eyewitness fashion the plague of blood, the plague of cattle disease, the plague of strange fire phenomena, the plague on the firstborn, the strange darkness, all the events that we previously thought we only knew about from the Bible. We can read about it in Egyptian records.
As the Bible describes, the last of the plagues arrived with great drama. God had instructed every Israelite to stay indoors and prepare a meal of lamb or goat. They were to take the blood of the animal and use it as a mark over the door of their houses. On that night, the angel of death descended on the land of Egypt, and the firstborn in every Egyptian family was struck down in death. The final plague was the most terrible. Pharaoh lost his beloved son. His resistance was broken. He ordered that the Israelites be set free. They must leave the land of the Nile completely. The Bible says that God provided a cloud column by day and a column of fire by night to guide the Israelites through the desert. According to the Bible, God instructed Moses to make a camp between Migdol and the sea. Their destination was to be the land of Canaan. But Pharaoh soon had a vindictive change of heart and sent his army in pursuit of the refugees with instructions to kill them all.
The spies have returned from Ramses. Pharaoh resents our release now and sends his army to destroy us.
We must put the sea between them and the people.
Have your scouts been able to find any place that we might possibly cross?
There is nothing to the north or to the south. In a week, we might be able to reach the road at Horus in the north. But that would be far too late.
And worse. And we should become a great temptation for the Philistines to come down on us from the north.
Can you place your men-at-arms between Pharaoh and the people?
There is not enough time. Except for the inner guard, my soldiers are dispersed amongst the tribes, trying to make warriors out of brickmakers and farmers. If I could gather them all, we would not be able to stop Pharaoh's archers and chariots.
According to the verses of Exodus 14, people quickly learned of Pharaoh's change of heart.
The Egyptians were working us to death slowly.
But now Moses has found a quicker way to kill us.
Do all of us despise so much eating from Egyptian flesh pots that we now must fill our stomachs with sand?
Listen to me. If we surrender peacefully, if we go back now, yes, we will be punished. But we will still be alive afterwards.
Which do you prefer? A few lashes or an Egyptian spear in your chest?
Does Moses think he can humble the mighty Pharaoh and still live? Let us tell Moses now.
Thank you.
be done.
Some critics express doubts that Moses and the Israelites crossed the Red Sea at all. Others do not believe any part of the Exodus. But recently, there has been the discovery of some remarkable proof.
There are certain hallmark pieces of pottery that we look for in attempting to trace the Exodus event and the migration of the Israelites into the land of Canaan. One of these pieces is this very nice pilgrim flask that's very nicely painted, and the shape itself apparently indicated the product that was shipped in it. It comes from Cyprus, but it's important for dating the other material that we find in connection with the Israelites. Another piece that we have is the Philistine beer jug. The Philistines were very fond of drinking beer. It was fermented right in the jug. You can see it was sieved as it was poured out into the drinking vessel itself. The Israelites copied the Philistine ware, which is very highly painted, and came out with a very poor reproduction. So we can always tell when we come into a site that the Israelites themselves have now moved on to this site. Daily, there are more and more pieces of evidence that are being excavated that are helping to demonstrate the fact that the Israelites came in the Exodus and settled in the land of Canaan.
One of the interesting questions that Emmanuel Anati has answered in his research, and he's one of the top Sinai archaeologist, is the question, what were the Israelites doing during the 40 years that they were wandering in a desert? Well, Dr. Anati has discovered something like 30,000 rock inscriptions which he dates to the time period of the Exodus, and which he believes the Israelites carved on those hot, weathered rocks.
New findings are being unearthed at several archaeological sites, such as the unusual pottery items in the rock drawings, which give hard evidence that the Exodus really did happen. But even as the validity of the Exodus is being scientifically proven, the controversy over the parting of the Red Sea is heating up.
The idea that the Red Sea could have parted into two walls of water, as portrayed in movies by Hollywood movie makers like Cecil B. DeMille, is just not credible.
At this site in 1799, Napoleon's engineers discovered an underwater ridge some 600 feet wide that extended from shore to shore. His engineers calculated the right time for crossing this 5.2-mile strip when the east wind would blow sufficiently to clear the seabed of water. Napoleon, however, barely escaped with his life when a sudden change in the wind's direction brought an onrush of water that covered the strip in just a matter of minutes.
Recently, Professor Doran Knopp of Florida State University, along with Dr. Norman Paldor of Israel, revealed their findings on the Red Sea crossing to the world press.
Dr. Paldo and I were not so much interested in whether crossing of the Red Sea occurred or not, but we were intrigued by the possibility that perhaps there is some explanation for a similar process. So what we did, we developed what we call in physical oceanography a mathematical model of the part of the Red Sea where many people believe that crossing could have been. Okay, what we have here now is a physical model of the Red Sea. The deep part supposed to represent the main body of the Red Sea, which is about 2,000 or 3,000 feet deep. And the shallow part, with the one with the sloping bottom, supposed to represent the Gulf of Suez, which is much shallower, as we said before. The average depth of the Gulf of Suez is about 100 feet, and the length is few hundred miles. Okay, what we have in addition to this, we have here, we introduced here an artificial ridge, which you see right here, and the depth of the water above that artificial ridge is only about 10 feet high. Okay, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to let the wind blow from here, and you will see how the water recedes and, in fact, exposes the ridge to the air. And so what you can see now is that most of the water, in fact, to the left of the ridge is blown away. There is still some water there. And you see that there is an exposed area right there. All right? So the idea is that the Israelis crossed on this part of the ridge which was exposed, and they saw water on the two sides, right? They saw the water on the left side of the ridge and the water on the right side. And I'm going to cut the wind off now, and I'm going to do that abruptly, and you will see how it comes back. So let's do that. In
course, what happens after that is that when the wind relaxes, the water wants to come back to the position that it had before, and it does that via a gravity wave, which moves at a speed we calculated to be like 15 feet per second or so, which is, of course, a speed that one cannot escape.
Oceanographers have established scientifically how the Israelites crossed the Red Sea in their escape from the pursuing Egyptians. The worldwide media coverage of the Knopf-Paldor experiments and findings leave no doubt that the Israelites could have crossed the Red Sea exactly as described in the Bible.
You have seen and heard both sides of the dispute. Is the Bible a complete and accurate history? Don't decide yet. This is only the beginning. What you are about to see will really startle and surprise you even more.
Traditional scientific theories insist that dinosaurs roamed the Earth millions of years before the first appearance of man.
Dinosaurs died off about 100 million years before human beings began to emerge on this Earth. As far as dinosaurs and people living at the same time are concerned, the Bible is clearly wrong.
You may wonder what dinosaurs have to do with this program on the Bible. There's a long-standing controversy between some scientists and religious scholars concerning the age of the Earth and the dates of events described in the Bible. On this issue, the world of science has received a series of surprises and some amazing recent discoveries.
The biblical view put forth in Job 40 and 41 is that behemoths, meaning gigantic beasts such as Diplodocus and the Brachiosaurus, lived together with humans less than 10,000 years ago and were mostly destroyed by the Genesis flood. A recent discovery that indicates that some marine reptiles survived the flood was made in 1977 when the nets of a Japanese fishing ship caught the decaying body of what is believed to be a plesiosaur.
There's now evidence from Russia, Australia, and several sites in the United States for humans walking the earth with dinosaurs. In 1983, the Russians found human and dinosaur tracks together, similar to this one that was found at Glen Rose, Texas. Here we find a human track within a dinosaur track.
Here at Glen Rose, Texas, in the Cretaceous limestone layers, we've excavated a nearly complete Acrocanthosaurus dinosaur, along with 203 dinosaur footprints, 7 cat prints, 57 identifiable human footprints, a confirmed human finger in the same Cretaceous limestone layering, and in adjacent area was discovered completely encased in Cretaceous sandstone an ancient hammer. In my view, these excavated evidences confirm that the Genesis account of the flood is viable, that the record of man and dinosaur living contemporaneously, as given in the book of Job, is correct.
Now that's something that will keep a lively debate going among scientists, skeptics, and believers alike.
There was never a biblical Ark of the Covenant. It's as fictional as the search for it in Indiana Jones in the Raiders of the Lost Ark.
There is ample archaeological and historical proof that the Ark of the Covenant exists exactly as described in the book of Exodus in the Bible.
The Ark or the chest that is described in the Bible, if it ever did exist, has long since been lost, probably in Solomon's time, and due to the fact that it had gold in it. It's probably disassembled for that very reason.
The Ark of the Covenant definitely existed, and it's very probable that it exists today. Now, on the verge of the 21st century, we may be about to see it brought to light.
Of all the many stories in the Bible, the Ark of the Covenant is often argued about the most. At the very core of this controversy is an ancient wooden chest covered with beaten gold, known throughout the world as the Ark of the Covenant. Its age is at least 3,500 years old. Let's start by seeing exactly what the Bible says the Ark was, and how it came into being.
According to the Bible, in chapters 25 through 30 of Exodus, God gave Moses explicit instructions for construction of the Ark. This was to be a chest covered inside and out with beaten gold, with two golden cherubim surmounting it. The ark would contain the stone tablets of the Ten Commandments, a jar containing the manna which saved the people in the desert, and the rod of Aaron, which was cast before Pharaoh, the holiest and most sacred objects of the Israelite people, always carried before them, even into battle, as a constant reminder to the people that the Lord God dwelt among them.
God has seen fit to bless our work, and he will bless this new work even more. For you are called upon to form out of the goods of the earth wood and stone, gold and silver, brass and iron, and cloth and skins, his holy objects, vessels and covers and instruments so sacred that their devising is out of God's own words.
You are but simple workmen, Lord. You are not the great architect of Egypt.
Be easy in your heart. God does not put upon the workman more than his worth.
First, God says you shall make an ark out of acacia wood, and it shall be 2 cubits and a half by length and 1.5 cubits in width, and in height also 1.5 cubits. And inside it shall be covered with beaten gold, and the outside also and rings of gold.
So Moses ordered the work to begin. All the canvases for the tabernacle had to be made and dyed just the right color. The woodworker, the metalsmith, the dyers and tanners, stone cutters and wool spinners worked all the hours when there was light. According to the Bible, the ark was finished and placed in the tabernacle. But is there evidence that the necessary technology existed for building this ark? And equally important, what was its significance? Why was it so sacred to the Israelites?
Yes, the technology existed at that time to build the ark. Similar gold-plated shrines existed in Egypt long before the time of Moses. As to the question of whether the ark really existed, there are many non-biblical historical references to support the fact. To the Israelites, undoubtedly the ark was their most sacred religious object, for it served as the footstool of the true God, and his divine presence was once visible there. Within the Ark of the Covenant were contained the 2 tablets upon which were written the 10 commandments, Aaron's rod that budded, and a pot of manna that once fed the Israelites during their long wilderness journey.
The Israelites believed that the Ark of the Covenant was responsible to allow them to walk across the Jordan River when it was miraculously dried up. The Ark of the Covenant was used when they surrounded the city of Jericho 7 times. The entire city fell into the ground, as archaeologists have verified. The Ark was used in battle after battle, and won victory after victory for the Israelites.
For 500 years, the Ark was the most precious and sacred object in the world. Children of Israel followed it into battle and into the promised land. As long as the people could see the ark, they knew God walked among them. When David became king, he brought the ark up to his new capital of Jerusalem. But some of the priests, as well as the people, had forgotten that it was forbidden to touch the ark.
King David, as we know, tried and failed to bring the Ark of the Covenant up to a newly built temple. Although he was allowed by God to prepare billions of dollars of material for the temple, because he was a man of war, God did not allow him to build it. Rather, his son, King Solomon, took those materials and built the most glorious golden temple the world has ever seen. The Bible records that the Ark of the Covenant was then successfully brought up to the temple. The Bible becomes strangely silent. The ark disappeared from history. And from that point, no one is sure from the Bible where the ark really is.
If you love a mystery, well, this is where it starts. There is no mention again of the ark in any active sense, but legend and stories There are more than enough. One of these is the two-arc proposal. In the Ethiopian version, cited in the Encyclopedia Britannica, Solomon is supposed to have had a duplicate of the ark made, which he gave as a present to Menelik, his son, by the Queen of Sheba. But the wily Menelik substituted the replica for the real ark, which he then carried to his capital in Ethiopia.
Although this is an intriguing account of where the ark might be located, there is an even more provocative Israelite account. The event occurred in 586 BC when the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar and his army were about to deliver the final destructive blow to Jerusalem. According to Jewish historians, this was anticipated and the temple took precautions to protect the ark.
The sins of this people must truly be an abomination in God's eyes. It's just a matter of hours, perhaps even minutes, before Nebuchadnezzar and the raging Babylonians are in upon us.
We must not let the ark fall into the hands of the pagans. We must take it to Solomon's vault.
The six of us are too old to carry the ark in the way that God instructed Moses.
We are young, Holy One, and waiting to serve God.
Give us your blessing and your order.
I send you to your death. You must be sealed within the tunnel.
My brother and I have lived our lives in the temple. We would end them here before any place in the world.
Your grace and forgiveness, Holy One.
The walls are breached, and the Babylonians are pouring into the city. You must flee, now!
Quickly, brethren. We must do it quickly.
The ark was buried under the Temple of Solomon, an underground tunnel, in thought lost forever. The most important evidence that the Bible is totally true would come from the rediscovery of the Ark of the Covenant. That's why so many have looked so hard for it. But does the Ark really exist? Did it ever exist? In 1981, an excavation took place on Temple Mount, in which three rabbis made a discovery that nearly set off another holy war between the Muslims and Jews.
If we look at this sketch of the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, we can see subterranean passageways superimposing upon this a model of the temple. The Jewish historical sources tell us that there was a chamber of wood, or a wood pen, underneath which was a secret chamber that King Josiah deposited the Ark of the Covenant in shortly before the destruction of the temple by the Babylonians. In 1981, three rabbis entered through Warren's Gate, one of the original entrances to the Temple Mount. They tunneled through and came to an area in which they claim they now have direct knowledge of the exact location of the Ark of the Covenant.
Do you believe that some of the temple treasures...
Yehuda Getz, chief rabbi of the Western Wall, was one of the tunnelers in 1981. Rabbi Getz states that he has found the Ark of the Covenant and its contents, including the tablets containing the original Ten Commandments, hidden for over 2,500 years in the secret vault beneath the temple. These incredible discoveries were also witnessed by Rabbi Shlomo Gorin.
We believe, we have enough reason to believe, that the Ark, the Holy Ark, made by Moses, many other items, very important items, are hidden just beneath the Holy of the Holies. Unfortunately, when we came so close, the Arabs started rioting and disturbing us, and the government became afraid. And they stopped us, they built just a wall, and we had to finish our digging.
So close to bringing the Ark of the Covenant out for the world to see, the Muslim Supreme Council, which oversees the Jerusalem Temple Mount, has sealed the tunnel in concrete, thus preventing any more excavations.
The evidence rather strongly supports the real ark being under the Temple Mount.
It's clear that the ark has been found under this mount. We can only hope that someday in our lifetime, this ban by the Muslims will be lifted, so the contents of this ark can be revealed to the waiting world wanting conclusive proof of the Bible's accuracy. Now you have seen and heard the pros and cons of the controversy surrounding the Ark of the Covenant. Of course, you will make your own decisions. But the evidence and weight of scientific opinion seem to favor the Bible's history. What will it be like if and when the Ark is recovered? What will be found inside when it is opened? Who will be selected to reach inside and withdraw the tablets of stone the Bible says God wrote upon? The idea is almost too stunning to ponder. And how will what is found inside change each and every one of us? Well, it's certainly something to think about. In addition to the many interesting facts we are learning about the Bible, we have discovered that over the centuries it has served as a scientific almanac, revealing insights on a variety of technical subjects, in some cases thousands of years ahead of its time.
In Isaiah 40:22, it says the earth is a sphere. This was not generally accepted until 2,200 years after Isaiah wrote it. Other biblical astronomy statements that were not confirmed until this century are the number of stars exceeds the billions, that each star is different, that the earth floats in space, and that light is in motion.
Ecclesiastes 1:6 tells us that winds blow in cyclonic patterns, something not confirmed until the late 1700s by none other than Benjamin Franklin, which are easily seen in satellite photos. The hydrologic cycle, which forms clouds from water evaporated over the ocean, as described in Job 36, verses 27 and 28, was not correctly understood until the late 1600s, when Edmund Halley, the famous astronomer, discussed it conceptually. A full mathematical explanation of this cycle did not occur until the 1800s.
2 Kings 20:20 reports that King Hezekiah of Jerusalem, in about 711 B.C., dug a secret tunnel under the city to bring water into the city. In 1880, based on this brief mention in the Bible, archaeologists discovered the tunnel, 1,700 feet long, cut through solid rock.
Matthew Morey, the father of oceanography, read in Psalm 8, verse 8, that there were paths in the sea. Taking the Bible for fact, he discovered the great sea currents in the trade winds, thus making sailing faster and safer.
As we have already seen, time and again, science is confirming the Bible. And now we see the Bible returning the favor, serving over the centuries to confirm scientific facts.
Stories like the walls of Jericho falling down at the blast of a trumpet are reasons people don't believe everything in the Bible.
We have a great deal of evidence, scientific evidence, that the walls of Jericho have collapsed by an earthquake, just as described by the Bible.
While Jericho is one of the oldest cities in the world, there's nothing on the site that relates it to the story of Joshua's conquest.
Even though Jericho is one of the oldest cities in the world, with many towns built one on the other, we can very precisely date the city that was destroyed by the Israelites as described in the Bible.
Among a list of the Bible's most controversial accounts, the book of Joshua is right up there at the top. Fact or fiction? Did the walls of Jericho come tumbling down with the sounding of trumpets? Biblical scholars believe that Joshua created the first Israelite army. Just as Moses had taken the slaves of Egypt and molded them into one people, so had Joshua made an army of fighting men out of farmers, potters, and tradesmen. Joshua's true name among his tribe of Ephraim was Hosea. Moses called him Joshua. The first test of the Israelite men-at-arms was not long in coming, for they were passing through a barbarous and hostile country.
Again! Again, attack into the Amalekite center! Attack in the name of Moses! In the name of Israel! In the name of God! Attack!
At Amalek, the green troops of Joshua were bloody. It's written that while Moses kept his arms raised, they were victorious. When he dropped his arms, the fighters began to fail. Then Moses called for support to keep his arms upraised the whole day, and the new fighting force under Joshua gained its first victory. There is little doubt that Joshua also served as Moses' personal bodyguard, and the prophet went up the mountain to talk to God. Joshua alone accompanied him. There were many small encounters with raiders, bandits, and quarrelsome tribes. But the Bible only mentions two more major battles while Israel was still in the wilderness. Heshbon, where the Amorites were severely defeated, and Bashan, where the cities and the arrogant king were humiliated and crushed. And when the greatest of all prophets knew his time had come, he anointed Joshua his successor and put the mantle of leadership upon him. According to the book of Joshua, the Jordan River stopped flowing to allow the Israelites to cross into Canaan so that Joshua could ready his attack on Jericho.
The idea that the Jordan River stopped flowing to let Joshua and the Israelites cross on dry land is one reason to question the entire book of Joshua.
Normally, the Jordan River flows too swiftly to be crossed by foot. But often after earthquakes, the river is dammed, sometimes up to a couple of days, like it happened in 1906. I'm convinced that the drying up of the Jordan River during Joshua's conquest was similarly a result of an earthquake.
The Bible tells us that the city of Jericho had to be destroyed. It was a pagan fortress of depravity, an abomination in the eyes of God, and the locked gate to the promised land. After Joshua had crossed the river, he sent spies into the city.
We put ourselves into a terrible position. Now the river is at our back. We have all the armed cities of Canaan before us.
My counselors believe we should move south. Start with a smaller campaign.
If Joshua insists on this madness, we will waste the flower of our army on those walls. Better to attack a less formidable position until we have time to build up our strength.
Good news. We have good news, worthy generals. The Amorite bastion is fat and ripe for an attack.
When will that be, General?
By the first of the new moon, brave Zebula.
That is a mere 7 days away.
God made the entire universe in less than that. 7 days, and Jericho will be ours.
Have you some news from the city? Would they give in without a fight? Are they asking covenant of us?
They scorn us and our presence. They're as strong and well supplied as we had imagined. They could withstand a siege of years.
Then how do we make this powerful pagan fortress ours? Surely not by throwing ourselves against those high and remorseless walls.
With faith, my able and worried commanders, God has spoken to me. And I will tell you the plan, for we begin at the break of dawn.
By your leave, mighty Joshua. We have less than 20% of our fighting men here. It will take weeks for us to strengthen our army.
This victory will not come by the strength of our arms, but by the power of God. That is why there is to be no prize taking, no looting, not one single armor of grain.
No prizes, no rewards. It's the city's full of grain. It would feed our people for months.
Nothing, generals, to be taken from the city. Our only purpose here is to destroy this abomination with the sword and with fire.
Perhaps, great Joshua, you might know how the Lord would have us do his bidding.
The ark will be called forth and placed in the center of the march. 7 priests with 7 trumpets will precede it. Each day, we will go forth in battle array and march around the walls once. No sound will come from the ranks. Only the blare of the trumpets will be heard.
For 6 days, the line of march went silently around the great walls, except for the sounding of the trumpets by the priests. Then on the 7th day, the host made 6 courses around the wall in complete silence. But at the end of the 7th march, thank you. Jericho's walls. Is it possible that science can shed any light on the mystery of how it might have happened? And can they tell us when it happened by astronomical dating?
Ancient people did not have clocks and calendars as we have today. They looked at the sky to tell time. Any date that was given was based on the phases of the moon, or the sun, or a combination of both. Astronomy is an exact science. Because of what we know about astronomy today, we can, with computers, go back and examine what these people said and duplicate it in the sky on a computer so that we can precisely date events. Using the references in the Bible, we've been able to determine that the walls of Jericho fell down on April the 9th, 1421 B.C. This would make the first circle around Jericho on April the 3rd of the same year. We can determine this by a solar eclipse that took place on Joshua's long day 10 days later. As we look at the screen, we notice that at 12 noon, over that particular area, the sun was being eclipsed by the moon, as you can see.
We have a great deal of evidence, scientific evidence, that the walls of Jericho have come up by North, just the way described in the Bible. The best evidence are the skeletons that were uncovered in Jericho, 1400 B.C., which were obviously destroyed by a collapsed wall.
Jericho was a very strongly defended city. It had two mud brick walls surrounding it. The archaeological evidence indicates that those mud brick walls collapsed, as described in the Bible, and probably that was due to earthquakes. Remnants of that wall are still there today. In fact, I have one of the mud bricks right here. It's about 3,400 years old. Now, if you'll look at this archaeological reconstruction with me, I'll show you how that happened. The city was surrounded by an outer stone revetment wall about 12 feet high. On top of that was a mud brick wall about 18 feet high. This is what the Israelites faced as they marched around the city for 7 days, according to the biblical account. Behind those walls was a massive earthen embankment that surrounded the entire city. At the crest of that embankment was yet another mud brick wall about 18 feet high. On this embankment, there were houses constructed. As the archaeologists excavated within the city, they found abundant evidence that there was earthquake activity at the time the city met its end. When they excavated at the base of this outer stone revetment wall, they found piles of collapsed mud bricks, as we see here in the drawing. This gave ample evidence that the biblical account was entirely correct. In the Bible, we're told that the walls fell flat. Here at Jericho, they found in almost every building great jars full of grain. Usually that would have been plundered because it was very valuable. The Bible tells us, however, that the Israelites were forbidden to plunder the city.
As we said at the start, the book of Joshua is very controversial. While the doubts are mighty and challenging, there are no proofs at all that the occurrences described in the book of Joshua did not happen. Scientific and analytical positions have demonstrated that everything the Bible says could have happened. For nearly two centuries, this book has faced constant challenges to its accuracy. The common criticism from skeptics is the stories that the Bible tells are merely exaggerated parables to illustrate religious beliefs, that it does nothing more than embellish old myths and legends. However, we've just seen how amazingly true these scripture passages have proven to be. But the Bible has survived the tests of time, not simply because its accounts are accurate. For the past 2,000 years, this remarkable book has demonstrated beyond doubt that it's far more than just a collection of stories and old tales. As it has for countless millions over the years, the Bible continues to provide comfort and solace in difficult times. It helps sustain faith and hope in the presence of fear. It offers motivation and encouragement when encountering the challenge of new beginnings. The Bible provides inspiration and guidance to face the uncertainty and wonder of tomorrow's yet to come.
The great theme of this book is brotherhood and our shared humanity. And the world is a better place for having heard its message. I'm William Devane. Thank you for joining us. Thank you.